All right, so we're very fortunate to have Karen Ray with us this morning as part of the American Character Series. Karen is truly a lifelong researcher and learner with expertise in history, political science, economics, and English. She was hired to our upper school 8 years ago after successful teaching stints at two other Milwaukee Christian schools in both the middle school and the high school. Here at BA, I'm most grateful that Karen has founded and continues to lead the Nathan Hatch chapter of the Rho Kappa History Honor Society. You might want to ask her about the name later, Nathan Hatch. I did mention that she was a researcher. Karen is a collector and archivist of primary source interviews. She gathers these stories purposed for classroom use. She specializes in veterans and their families' histories. She also serves, and I love this too, as a side guardian for the honor roll, honor flight. Honor flight. With a Master of Arts in European History and a Bachelor of Science from UW-Madison, we are pleased to have Karen speak to us about veterans, our ordinary heroes. Please welcome Karen.
Hi, everyone. Hi, thanks. Good morning, everyone, and happy Veterans Day to you. It's a special day. It's like one of my high holy days of the year as far as veterans are concerned. The other one, of course, is Memorial Day. This is my first time opportunity on this side of the camera for a lecture series. So thank you for your interest in this topic, veterans, which is near and dear to my heart. But why veterans? I honestly don't have a clue. I sometimes wonder if I picked the wrong career as being a teacher, but I have so much of a chance to teach students about veterans being a teacher. So again, just trying to find out why veterans? Well, my grandfather served as a submariner in World War I, but he was not a career man. In general, my family members were just citizen soldiers whose lives focused more on their own law careers than on the military's, and their stories were ones of battles fought in a courtroom, or in my grandfather's case, fought on the state legislature floor. Although my father apparently did want to be a pilot, he was rejected due to astigmatism and rejected again when he applied for helicopter training, which was supposed to be less stringent qualifications. And again, he was rejected for that. So come to think of it, we figured out later that he likely would have probably been deployed to Vietnam, where one out of every 10 military deaths was a helicopter crewman. So we're pretty glad that instead he served more as a reservist for the JAG Corps, which is the Judge Advocate General Corps. Again, so why veterans? I guess I just love the story. For me, it's not dates and dead people, as some of you have heard me say this already, but it's real people. They are ordinary people. They're just mostly ordinary people making choices in extraordinary situations. They grab our attention, they grab our imagination, and definitely our respect. I began the interview project about 30 years, oh my gosh, 30 years ago. Wow, about 30 years ago. And since then, veterans have generously provided more than 4,000 pages of primary source material. Let me just kind of get a little bit into how I got started on this. My parents were planning a family trip to France. And I had, you know me, I'm a historian. Well, you know, I'm a history buff. And so I started researching France and all that I could about France. And then I got to Stephen Ambrose's book, D-Day, and I got stuck on the beaches. We were actually going in the year that was the 50th anniversary of the landings, the D-Day landings at Normandy. So it was all the more important. So I read Stephen Ambrose's book, and then I read Pegasus Bridge. And so I've just become a huge World War II nut. Anybody who knows me, I'm just gonzo about World War II.
I ended up in Bozeman, Montana.
And was in the airport. I was out there for an environmental economics seminar and was talking to the fellow next to me who himself was a World War II veteran. And he was telling me stories of flying into France. He was a pilot flying into France, you know, from England into France. And the tires on the airplane blew out as they landed in the field. And he was telling me about how the French underground had to work with him to get him back to England. And as I was talking with him, I was thinking, why am I not recording this? I need to write this down so my students can hear these stories, these fascinating stories and amazing stories that veterans tell us. And so that began, how am I going to get so many veteran interviews? And it happened to be the VFW National Convention was in Milwaukee shortly after that. So I created a veteran interview form, and I had contacted the VFW, but did not hear back from them. It was a very busy time for them. And so I was not anyone important for them. But my dad said, Karen, why don't you just head on down? Just go on down to the convention, take your interview forms down there. I said, Dad, I can't. That's rather audacious. And he said, honey, the worst they can say is no. So there I went. I went on down with my stack of veteran interview forms, and they didn't know what to do with me, but they ended up directing me towards the Patriots Pen Voice of Democracy student scholarship table. And there they allowed me to put my stack of veteran interviews on their table, and I got to talking with veterans. And that then also connected me with the VFW Voice of Democracy competition, which our ROCAPA students all participate in on an annual basis. And it also introduced me to just some wonderful, wonderful people. And by the way, it was an election year coming up. So there was a presidential candidate who was speaking down at the convention that year. And it was also a year that the VOD winner, the Voice of Democracy winner, talked about the Berlin airlift and the candy bomber. And I'd never heard about the candy bomber before, Halvorsen, Mr. Halvorsen. So his is an interesting story as well. And I make sure that my students hear about the candy bomber when I talk about the Berlin airlift. I have to also say that Bob Dole was one of those who responded to my veteran interview form. And when I had a chance to meet him on a family trip to Washington, D.C., I asked him, what is one thing you want me to tell my students? And he said, tell your students that we couldn't have done it without the home front. So whenever I do teach World War II, to my students, I say, we've got to remember the home front. It could not have been done without the support of those on the home front. So the value of family and the necessity of family at this time as well. Well, let me get into my talk here then. So I began the Veteran Interview Project about 30 years ago. And since then, veterans have generously provided more than 4,000 pages of primary source material for me. Their interviews provide insight that textbooks can never convey. Their stories are amusing. They are tragic. They are stories of different generations and of different wars and even from different national origins. And yet they all share the wealth of human experience. Let me give you some examples of what they have shared with me. They've shared with me about typhoons and the great green wall of water that's higher than their ship. And how the onboard ship, and again, a ship, not a boat, it's a ship, I'm learning vocabulary as well, of chaining the jeeps on the main deck, chaining them down to prevent the loss from being overboard. I've learned about veterans in the, stationed in the Pacific Theater who would put squid in wheelbarrows full of water, and then they would have wheelbarrow races with the squid, of soldiers who were bored because there's a lot of downtime. It would be jerry-rigging jeeps in order to make them steer in opposite directions so that if there was an officer who was driving the jeep, they wouldn't know how to drive the jeep. They've told me about Goonie birds laying heads on the card tables while the veterans are playing cards. Shenanigans with alcohol, for example, throwing one of the life rings out into the water, having the beer floating with it because they weren't allowed to have alcohol on board the ship. Or of pilots who would fly their ships high or fly their planes high enough in the altitude so that it would cool off the beer so that they could deliver some cold brew in a hot South Pacific day. I learned about hot dogs that were green in the center. I've learned about veterans who will never again eat orange marmalade or that hard coffee candy because that's all that was available when the food ran out. They've shared stories, for example, on submarines of taking off hats in the mess area because that's where men have died on the table because those tables have doubled as a surgery. of the submarine officers today who can distinguish the sounds of the shrimp beds by the little clicking noises that they hear, of secret missions during the Cold War, of creeping forward in tunnels and listening underground, of those who were serving in tank units, ready at a moment's notice during the Cold War, just in case the communists decided to overrun the German border, of MREs, meals ready to eat, heating them up underneath armpits or laying them on the engines of their vehicles to warm them up, otherwise they came cold, of SOS, and as one of my students would say, Mrs. Ray, that's like naughty word on a shingle, which is basically chipped beef on toast, on a piece of toast. But what really mattered was if you had a good company cook, because a good company cook could make that SOS into something that was a favorite. So you always wanted to have a good company cook. I've learned about a fellow crash landing on an island inhabited by pygmies, and everybody else was about half his height, of the experience of our veterans when they freed inmates from concentration camps in Germany, of directions in the Gulf War, like, well, turn left at the burned out truck and then right at the dead camel because everything looks the same in the desert, or of even in that desert, those ugly camel spiders, which really isn't a spider, but it's ugly all the same. So I've learned about so much of flora and fauna and weather and geography, and of history lessons. Those like from a Nisei Japanese American veteran who taught me that there were Japanese Christian missionaries who landed on the West Coast years before the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock. And of the Japanese submarines that hovered off the fog bank off of California, just as the German submarines were also hovering off the banks of New York, and they were so close that they could hear the sounds from Coney Island. Of Cold War excursions into East Berlin. So during the 1960s, is that Jonathan Green, who used to have the WTMJ greenhouse radio program, told me of going into East Berlin, going through Checkpoint Charlie and into East Berlin, and how when he got into East Berlin, everything was just gray and drab and muffled and quiet, and they could still see the bullet holes in the buildings. And as he turned around, he looked towards West Berlin, and it was like a carnival. There were lights and music and laughter, but then again with East Berlin, under this communist kind of control, that the stores that were the tourist stores that had, you know, things that people could buy, how the stores were empty. The shelves were empty. There wasn't much to bring back as a souvenir from East Berlin. Stories like that that teach us about the history, what life was like. Again, these are things that I never see in a textbook. Stories from POWs. We have this interesting one of a Japanese POW at Sugamo Prison in the aftermath of World War II, who apparently had hemorrhoid surgery prior his execution. The veteran brought it up. He thought it was one of those oddities of war. Of course, we have the serious issues as well of POWs, American POWs, being beaten for having an American flag or for refusing to bow to the Japanese flag. Of being a POW in a German Stalag camp and finding a horse tooth in the broth and then keeping that horse tooth and bringing it home. I guess that's his souvenir. But Mr. Gallner, how he would celebrate two birthdays. One birthday would always be the day of his birth, and the other one would always be the day that he was liberated from being a POW. The story of a certain chaplain, an American chaplain, who parachuted into a German POW camp to minister to the American soldiers who were there, who was beaten by the German guards, but he refused to leave, and so he was allowed to stay. Or of the ring of bare dirt around the perimeter of a POW camp, an arm's length of reaching under the barbed wire to grab the grass and to eat it. Stories from those who actually worked on the railroad for the bridge over the River Kwai, and how they ate pebbles and stones just so their stomachs would feel full because they were so hungry. Or when at that same POW site, new clothing and bananas were distributed for pictures, but then once those photos were taken, of course, the clothing and the bananas were taken away. How do how do people survive such difficulties? For example, how does a German boy at age 8, how does he survive being hauled off to serve as a munitions boy in his army that's losing to the Americans, to serve in a winter that is so cold that the guns actually froze? And how does this boy, who, to keep warm, having taken a uniform off of a dead fellow countryman, was then captured by Russians who basically arrested him because he was wearing that uniform, and who, even as a child, was hauled off as a prisoner of war to Siberia, and yet who, again, at age 12, managed to make his way back from Siberia all the way to Germany to reunite with his mother and sister, and then later immigrated to the United States and find employment as a tool maker. And as a tool maker, I had the privilege that, or he was the tool maker, that I had the privilege of interviewing him in my dining room. And my boys were about that age. My boys were about the age that he was when he became a munitions boy and when he made his way back to his home family. James Ballou, Stanley Gruber, Roland Campbell, John Crott, Chris Mittman, Clarence Myra, Mike Krause, Howard Gollner, although I had mentioned Howard Gollner earlier, ordinary people, all in extraordinary circumstances. Responses to one of the questions on the interview form surprised me. The question is this: during the war, who was someone you really respected and why? Now, who would you expect that answer to be? I'll kind of pause a little bit and let you kind of think about that. Who would you expect them to respond as their answer? I personally expected to see, FDR, Eisenhower, MacArthur, and yes, there were some of those who mentioned these great historical figures, but for the great majority, the uber majority, the super majority, most of them mentioned the officers immediately above them or someone who was just one more higher in rank than that officer. It wasn't the great historical figures that impacted the veterans the most. It was those who were just ordinary, those whose names will never make it in the history books. Names of staff sergeants, squad leaders, commanding officers, platoon sergeants, buddies, shipmates, skippers. And one veteran even mentioned those who showed up even though they didn't want to be there and still did the job. Or such specific names as Captain John Moore, Colonel John Heintzes, Lieutenant Rick Tunney, Sergeant Sergeant Lloyd C. Meeks, Harold Tex Durham, Bob Jaworski, Mr. Pay Leitner, Max Meyer, Chippy Chipman, Marty Weil. Again, ordinary people we will never read about in a history book. Yet, all having significant impact. And that challenges me. And I think it challenges us all as well. In a book called Leadership, the Warrior's Art, it's published by the Army War College Foundation Press, an excerpt reads this: leaders understood that the power of example was most influential in such situations, and their willingness to accept risk and sacrifice was often necessary to stimulate their soldiers to do the same. Such leaders, by their actions, conferred a sense of protection on their soldiers. Leaders who took care of their soldiers, who met their tactical needs through their own competence and skills, and who provided them the administrative and logical means to do their jobs well, especially the prompt medical support to justify a willingness to risk wound and injury, and who allayed their soldiers from anxieties that they would respect their lives by avoiding wasteful casualties. These leaders led units that were the most effective in combat. And I have to ask myself, am I that type of leader? Will my students say the same thing of me? Will those of under all of us, under our own leadership, however that leadership may be, will they view us the same way? B.T. Collins viewed Sam Byrd in this following story, saying this. It's entitled The Courage of Sam Byrd. It's just a small excerpt that I have here for you. Byrd was my fourth company commander. This is from Vietnam. And my expectations were somewhat cynical when he called all of us officers and sergeants together. I understand this company has been in Vietnam almost a year and never has had a party, he said. Now, we officers and sergeants, we had our little clubs to which we repaired, but he announced, Bird announced, the men are going to have a party and they are not going to pay for it. Do I make myself clear? A party for the grunts was his first order of business. Sam Bird had indeed made himself clear. We all chipped in. We got food and beer for about 160 men. And the troops themselves, they were surprised almost to the point of suspicion. After all, who had ever done anything for them? But that little beer and bowl session was exactly what those war-weary men needed. Its effect on morale was profound, and I began to watch our captain more closely. During the monsoon season, we had to occupy a landing zone. The torrential wind-driven rains had been pounding for weeks. Like everyone else, I sat under my poncho in a stupor. Nobody cared that the position, the landing zone, was becoming flooded. We had all just crawled inside ourselves, and suddenly I saw Sam, Mr. Spit and Polish, with nothing on but his olive drab undershorts and his boots. He was digging a drainage ditch down the center of the camp. He didn't say anything, just dug away, mud spattering at his chest, steam rising from his back and his shoulders, and slowly, sheepishly, we emerged from under our ponchos, shovels in hand, and we began helping the old man to get the ditch dug. We got the camp tolerably dried out, and with that one single act, transformed our morale. That was the way Sam Bird taught leadership, put the troops first. Know that morale often depends on small things. Respect every person's dignity. Always be ready to fight for your people. Lead by example. Reward performance. I'd like to play a movie clip for you. It comes from the movie Saving Private Ryan. The setting is the Normandy beaches, D-Day. A patrol led by the character played by Tom Hanks is on a mission to find the family's last surviving son, Private Ryan. The patrol has unnecessarily come across an ambush hotspot, and one of its men has been killed in the process. In this clip, the men in the patrol are near mutiny. Tom Hanks' character is the one to watch. Let's watch the clip.
Hey!
Sir.
Don't you walk away from your captain. Ryan, get back in line.
No, sir. I'll spend the rest of my life in the stockade if I have to, but I'm done with this.
I'm not gonna ask you again, soldier.
Captain!
Now this is... Fall in!
You gonna shoot me over, Ryan?
No, I'm gonna shoot you because I don't like you.
Sir, listen, I got...
If he wants to go, just let him go.
Are you gonna shoot me?
Are you letting this happen? Captain! You see this?
Captain. Sir, Ryan's dead.
We have a situation! Get in on...
Captain, I have a sixth sense about these things. I know it in my bones.
You don't kill that son of... Now you're gonna shoot me.
Huh? He's better than you.
Then why don't you just do it, Sarge? Do it, man. Put one in my leg and give me that million dollars.
I'm gonna shoot through your big mouth.
Well, put your money where your mouth is and go with it. Do it.
You don't know how to shut up.
Pull the trigger already.
Captain, please.
Give me that. What's the pull on me up to?
I'll do it. I will do it. Robin!
You are a coward, son of a...
I'm waiting,
Sarge. Sarge!
I'm
waiting. What's the pull on me up to right now? What's it up to? What is it? $300? Is that it? $300? I'm a school teacher. I teach English composition. This little town called Adley, Pennsylvania. In the last 11 years, I've been at Thomas Alva Edison High School. I was a coach of the baseball team in the springtime. Back home, and I tell people what I do for a living. They think, well, now that figures. But over here, it's a big mystery. So I guess I've changed some. Sometimes I wonder if I've changed so much, my wife is even going to recognize me whenever it is I get back to her. And how I'll ever be able to tell her about days like today. Ryan. I don't know anything about Ryan. I don't care. Man means nothing to me. It's just a name. But if... You know, if going to Rommel and finding him so he can go home, if that earns me the right to get back to my wife, well, then... Then that's my mission. You want to leave? You want to go off and fight the war? All right. All right, I won't stop you. I'll even put in the paperwork. I just know that every man I kill, the farther away from home I feel.
Ordinary people, ordinary heroes. As a dear veteran told me, as I wrap up here, the mind can absorb only what the seat can endure. So I try to remember that with my class. But as I close, I do close with this. My hope is that the stories shared here with you today will inspire you likewise to meet really the extraordinary challenge of being ordinary. To be an ordinary hero to those around you, and for me, the challenge as well, in the day to day, as parents, as staff, the impact on our children, your family, grandchildren, that impact is immeasurable. No, it will never make the history books, and no one beyond your circle may ever really know about it, but you bring value and meaning and purpose just by being in that relationship. I encourage all of us on this Veterans Day to honor the spirit of the day, to honor our veterans, to follow their examples of leadership, of duty, of sacrifice, of seeing the humor in the oddest things, of seeing through some of the most painful things, of serving our best to each other on a daily basis, to make it all worthwhile by honoring the values and freedoms for which they have sacrificed so much for. Because I'll tell you, veterans will tell you, that the heroes are the ones who never came home. Their lives, their limbs, their families, their own peace of mind, so that we could have ours. So all ordinary people, all ordinary heroes, thank you so much, and a happy Veterans Day, everybody. God bless.
Thank you so much. That was really moving, that video clip too, Karen. Thank you so much. But we can take a few minutes here. Karen would be willing to take some questions. If anybody wants to, they should just unmute themselves and go right ahead. Do I have anyone interested in a question right now? I can't tell if, because I don't see everybody.
Some of the questions that I asked for the veterans was actually began with very basic generic information, you know, name, rank, serial number. There's a lot to be learned from a serial number, and of course we don't hand out they don't give their serial numbers anymore because they are their Social Security numbers. But then it went into, you know, where were they stationed, what were their jobs in the military. Again, there's a wealth of information of what military jobs are. What did they wear? What kind of food did they eat? What did they do for entertainment on board ships? They could have movies that were shown. Otherwise, if guys were in the Army, they just you know, sat around, told stories, saying that kind of thing. The questions that dealt with hygiene, personal hygiene. Sorry. It's tough to have personal hygiene when you're in the Army. Yeah. And especially during World War II, there's stories of, we all just had bad breath, you know, nobody cared. Using their helmet as a little wash basin kind of idea. Then some of the other questions got a little bit more serious, although, or more intense, the idea of, you know, with anything humorous or strange that they saw. But then the next question was, or were they ever nervous, angry, or scared? And the veterans said that they were always nervous, always scared, that you'd be crazy not to be nervous or scared in a combat situation. And some of them gave some very deep answers as far as the impact that it had. I know that some of them are permanently scarred from, emotionally scarred from some of the things that they experienced. I'm thinking of one of the Vietnam veterans who had to make a choice between shooting a child that had bombs strapped to him or saving his unit. And that Vietnam veteran has never recovered from that. Other things that I asked in the veteran in the interview form, had they ever, you know, had they ever gotten any kind of awards or honors? And many of them Purple Hearts, of course. I also asked who was someone that they respected and why. I asked them what is something that they would want to tell that I, as a teacher, what would they want me to tell my students in the classroom? And almost all of them said, avoid war as much as possible. It's a last resort. It's a dirty business. It's a stinky business. The textbooks and even movies can never, ever really adequately convey the smells and everything else that goes into it. Try to avoid war as much as possible. And then the last question for them was, what is something you will never, ever forget? And the story of Mr. Payleitner, who was flying bombing missions over Europe, and when his last mission landed in England, how he got out of the plane and kissed the ground. And as Mr. Payleitner was telling me about this, how he started crying, and I will never forget that. How dear that moment to him was still after all these years, World War II veteran, breaking down and crying with me, and the value of doing a job and doing it well and surviving. And so it's a fascinating project, and I hope someday to be able to publish more of it, but for now it's brought into my students. I bring these stories in. Yes.
Karen, as I listen to you talk about all your interviews, I really don't want them to be lost, all that paper, all those 4,000, right? We need, even if you don't formally publish it in a book, just make sure it gets saved forever.
Right now, they're all hard copies. That's that's the problem of loving history. You're afraid to throw anything away because it's a primary source, and these definitely won't be thrown away. And but if anybody out there really has suggestions for this, as I said, I have storage bins filled with these primary sources that were handwritten by veterans. They're you know, if you have ideas as to ways how to do that, time is of course going to be a huge factor, because to scan all of that is an enormous amount of time. But certainly something needs to be preserved about it, and ideas on how to do that are welcome.
I have one other question, Karen. You know, when you see a veteran, a lot of times we make a point of going up to them and saying something, thanking them. Do they like that?
Yes.
They appreciate
yes.
that?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes. And what's really amazing too, is that so many of them, they just keep giving, you know, not everybody serves in a combat zone. And I want to especially emphasize this as well, is that I have had veterans who have apologized to me. Oh, I didn't see combat. It's like, don't apologize for that. Every single part is important. The mechanics are so important. The clerks are important. Everything all works together for the whole system all together. And those who are stationed in Iceland who seem as though, well, you know, they're not seeing any action, but that position is so important. And I want all of our veterans to recognize the value of serving, because many of them are serving away from families, and it's a cost on their families as well. This is not just the veteran, it's everybody who's involved with it, and to support them. And when they hear that thank you, they do. They really appreciate it.
Great. Well, I really have, it was a moving presentation. I really enjoyed it very, very much, Karen. I think I'm going to close this up, and I'm giving you one last chance if someone has a burning question.
Otherwise, I've got a couple questions, Linda. It's
okay,
Mike.
Good.
Karen, hi, Mike Kaiser. Couple questions. in all of your interviews and stuff, can you talk to, you know, you just kind of mentioned it about the folks that saw active duty versus the folks that maybe were active during wartime but weren't on the front lines versus those who maybe were active duty in peace times. You know, you've got the, you know, the VFW, right, which is, you know, kind of a you know, subset of veterans that can be members of that. Do you get a sense from the veterans of, I don't know, a hierarchy or a ranking or a I'm better than you because I served during wartime? Or how can we understand that the discrepancy or the differences between, you know, what we really should respect as all veterans, regardless of whether it just happened that there was wartime at the time they were serving?
Is your question as regards to veterans towards civilians or veterans towards other veterans?
Yeah, veterans towards other veterans.
I have, you know, there is a little something about that. When I look at especially Vietnam veterans, that veterans who served in Vietnam versus those who served in the Vietnam era. And I do hear a little bit about, oh, yeah, they served during the era. I don't think I think that's amongst the veterans themselves to try and deal with that. But I can tell you that having served with having worked with the Milwaukee Side Guardians for Honor Flight, we honor all of them. You know, the Honor Flight honors all of them, whether they served, during the era itself and never saw action, or whether they actually saw action, everyone is treated with their service to the country. I don't know if that fully answers your question, but I have seen a little bit of it.
It does. I just, it seems interesting to me that, you know, you'd have a VFW, for example, where, I mean, my understanding is that's veterans of foreign wars. So is it true that like you can't be a member of that unless you served during, you actually were personally overseas? Is that my understanding?
Yes. There's also the American Legion, and there are other, you know, there are Vietnam veteran organizations and there are other veteran organizations, but VFW itself is veterans of foreign wars. It tends to be an older organization that those who are in the Gulf Wars, they tend to have their own. I have seen some young guys in the VFW, but it tends to be much more of an older organization. There is also the VFW Ladies Auxiliary. So women who have family members who have served overseas as well. So there are women's organizations that are affiliated with these as well.
Thanks.
So Karen, we also have the question, is there another appropriate way to say thank you to veterans? What do you think? You know, I mentioned.
You mean like just going, you know, besides going up and thanking them?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, that's an interesting question because sometimes veterans just, some veterans just don't even make a big deal out of it. During the time of this interview project, which focused most heavily on World War II, because I wanted to make sure I could get as many primary sources, as many veterans as I could, because that's a generation that's rapidly dying, and I feel the loss of each one. That sometimes there were I found veterans who had never spoken about their experiences to their families at all. And in receiving my interview form, it actually gave them a way to talk with their families. Some veterans, it's like they just compartmentalize, you know, that was that time of my life. And now this is my new time, this is what I'm doing now. That was then, this is now. And so, you know, some of them might not be as open about it. Those who are open about it, you know, I think just certainly just to be friendly with them, if you see them. Get involved in volunteer type organizations. Like I've got involved with the Honor Flight, making contributions to certain veteran organizations, you know, financial support. There's so many ways out there. I think passing along that respect of veterans to our children is something that's really important. I think we live in an America that tends to be a little bit cynical. And I think all of us as parents or siblings or aunts and uncles, if we can just have an attitude of respect, I think that's kind of a catching attitude. So if not anything financial or written, whatever, an attitude of respect for America, for the flag, for those who serve, no matter when they served or where they served. And granted, with the Vietnam era, many of those veterans are still very much in pain because of the lack of welcome that they received. However, I think America learned from that. And so we do welcome our veterans back after they've come home from service. So I think attitude almost more than anything, one that respects the veterans and respects their families and their kids and understands the special needs of the families and the kids as well. Being willing to help those families and kids that, if you know that one of the members is deployed, do something special for the kids, take them out. Well, of course it's COVID right now, but just do something special for them. So it means a lot. It means a lot.
This is great. Thank you so much. I really, really enjoyed that and appreciate it. I just want to let all of our guests know that I will be sending you a recording of this. And I definitely think that her idea of like sharing that respect with your children, there are definitely stories in here you could share with your own kids. So I'll be sending you that. And then a bonus, I'm going to send you a little video that was done and for this morning for the lower and primary school students by Chris Shore. Chris Shore is a lieutenant colonel in the Marines. It's been his career in the Marines, and he graduated from Brookfield Academy. He knows the five stars well, and we asked him to share with our students a message about Veterans Day. And I listened to it the other day. It is so great and so just really inspiring. So I'm going to send that to you, and I encourage you to share that. Your children have seen it, but maybe to listen to it yourself and have a conversation around it with them. And I think that's speaking directly to what Karen is saying, like showing your children what your respect for the veterans is. So two things will be coming your way. And then on November 24th, we have our final American Character Series presentation, which is The Morality of Markets. Are free markets really moral? And it's being given by a past Brookfield Academy teacher, Bruce Rotman. He's out in California now, but he's going to Zoom in for us. So I want to thank you all for supporting this project that I'm trying to get off the ground even during COVID. So thank you all for your attendance. Thank you, Karen, and everybody have a great day. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everyone.